All the July 18th, 2023, meeting of the Mobility and Transportation Infrastructure Commission, into session. So, Liana, will you please call the roll? Or Mark? Is it
Chair,
Mark?
yeah, it's
All
Mark.
right.
Chair Dunlap,
Here.
Vice Chair Hughes, Commissioner Abelson,
Here.
Commissioner Fisher,
Here.
Commissioner Zavala, excuse, Councilmember Donovan, not here at this time. Staff present, Ted Gerber, Liana DeWitt, David Pena, you have a quorum.
Thank you. And I will ask Vice Chair Hughes to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, if she may.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Everyone, please rise.
All right, thank you. Our first item on the agenda is public comment. So these are items that are not agendized tonight, but just general public comment that on items that are under the purview of the Mobility and Transportation Infrastructure Commission. We'll put a 3-minute time limit on each public comment. And Mark, do we have any public comment?
We have one public comment in person, and if there's anyone on Zoom, please raise your hand. The first public comment in person is Ben and Dana Slosson. Sorry.
Great. If you'll just come up and restate your name, and you may begin.
Continuing to be, top of mind and present until we get some sort of resolution.
Thank you. And maybe Director Gerber, can I invite you up to kind of share a little bit about maybe even the process as it relates to street resurfacing and.
Yeah, absolutely. And I had an opportunity to talk to Dana and Ben real quick before the meeting. I was explaining that, we'll get into this as we get into the project status update, but as far as the percentage of streets that we're able to repair in a given year is very much budget constrained. So I have a map I can show you to explain some of what we've been working on, that'll show that, you know, even though we're putting millions of dollars per this year's CIP budget, it kind of just scratches the surface with street resurfacing. And so what we're working on now, as you recall from our April meeting, is a revised approach to prioritization of streets so that we can present that to the commission and to the council for buy-in in terms of you know, how we're selecting streets and also what's an appropriate budget to meet the expectation of increasing the quality of streets across the city. For their particular street, Martos, since their comment last meeting, we did have our staff try to make some improvements in terms of filling potholes and things like that. But in talking to them, it doesn't sound like that was what was expected. I hadn't gotten a chance to take a look at it myself. So we can try to take another stab at Martos in terms of what our staff ability to make some improvements. Again, it's not going to be a reconstruction effort or even a resurfacing effort if that's what's needed. That will have to come later. And again, we don't have a timeline for that particular street just yet, but hopefully we can make some improvements in terms of, you know, pothole filling and things like that. I will add that we did ask, we are asking council, we did set aside money for a brand new asphalt truck that can do hot patch work, which we're currently not capable of. Right now, we just do, if you're familiar with it, just cold asphalt shovel filling potholes and cracks like that. It's not a high quality repair. So I'm hopeful that that might offer something in terms of better than what we're doing now. But again, and like many places in the city, there's a massive deficit in terms of street quality for many, many reasons. So hopefully that helps.
Yeah, certainly it does. And thank you so much for your public comment and for keeping this talk top of mind.
Yeah, absolutely. And one thing we mentioned to Ted, like he said, we appreciate there. It sounds like there was some attempt made. We're both home a substantial amount and we work from home. We're happy to meet anyone from the city or at the site to kind of walk, understanding that we would still like a long-term solution of having the entire street repaved. I think that that's based on the condition very much required, but as a short-term solution, we're happy to walk through and point out where there's like loose gravel, where we've tripped, where we've seen other people trip, as like a short-term solution. Like we are happy to work together to try and make it a bit better for the interim.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea. We'll definitely take them up on that offer. You know, like I mentioned so many times, like if we can get staff is following, you know, hundreds and hundreds of work order requests, and they're just basically knocking them out one at a time. So if we can get some specific attention to some focused areas, we can pass that direction to staff and hopefully get a better job at what they're asking.
Great.
So
thank you. And thank you for bringing this up. You know, I think you're, Commissioner Abelson said that that's one of the reasons why he got involved with the commission in the past, was just kind of the state of his street. And so
absolutely,
certainly the state is certainly in a very disrepair if you look at the entire network. And so it sounds like this year there's going to be some work done as far as the process in the future for identifying streets and how that's done and ensuring that the streets with the greatest need are taken care of.
A quick question. Can you tell me your street number again of the property on Martos?
We're 531.
4531?
It's 531.
531. Okay. And then question, Ted, sort of related. We used to have, I recall we had a contract for hot asphalt at one point, and we must have lost it somehow. Because I can remember when that was added, and that was one of the solutions that we had put in place as a city to try to mitigate our, you know, long backlog of necessary street mitigation.
I believe at some point city had various maintenance contracts, not just, you know, asphalt repair, but also striping and marking. Those are long gone. We're trying to reestablish those for some of the things we're talking about, council, especially some of the items we'll talk about on our project status update tonight. That's the key is the financing end of that. As you know, through the budget process, we are in a deficit year. And so we have to make sure that we're making those capital investments. From the procurement side is making that project delivery as smooth as possible. Goes back to, you know, how the city handles procurement. So that is our goal, is reestablishing those one at a time. We've spent a lot of time this year doing that throughout Public Works. You'll notice those items on the council agenda, pretty much every agenda. We're bringing a new 3-year contract so we can have maintenance services in a particular area. We're working through those challenges.
And I think Commissioner Abelson has a comment. And then we'll end this item because I think we're moving beyond the scope of a public comment item and we'll move on to the next public comment.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Chair. So thank you for coming back. I wanted to let you know that the morning after last month's meeting, I walked my dog over to your street. It's one of the few streets I haven't hit yet living in the city, and took a look at it and saw some of the issues that you shared. And I took pictures of what I thought were the worst spots and sent them to staff. And I went back, can't remember if it was today or yesterday, but to see if anything had been addressed, and they had patched the areas that seemed to be the worst when I saw them. But if there are others that temporarily that we can patch to try to address some issues, I'm sure staff will work with you to get that done.
Okay, yeah. Great. No, and we very much appreciate you making the effort. We did notice like a couple of spots that had been filled, but
we're trying
there. Yeah. Slowly but surely. There are definitely a few right in the middle that still are a little tricky.
Okay.
So
great.
Yeah, we appreciate you filling those too.
Terrific. Thanks
awesome.
So much.
Thank you guys.
Thank you.
Have a good night.
Mark, any additional public comment?
Thank you.
We do not have any additional public comment.
All right. Thank you so much. And with that, we will move to our first informational report. That is a presentation from Mr. Pena. and on the Fremont and Huntington Drive corridor planning project.
Good evening, Chair Dunlap and commissioners. Good to see you all again at the commission meeting. Today, we want to present an item that we kind of been discussing over the last couple of months, specifically an update on the Fremont and Huntington Drive corridor project update. So today, we wanted to give you an update on the first step of the planning process that we have embarked on. So just to give you a little background on what's been going on the last few years, back in 2009, there was a consultant who conducted a traffic calming concept plan for Fremont Avenue. That plan was envisioned back in 2009. However, it never really transitioned over to a construction phase. So over the last few years, the Public Works team has attempted to make some improvements and along these different corridors, but there hasn't been anything significant like a capital improvement project along Huntington Drive, Fremont Avenue, or some of these other major arterials. And as you know, more recently, we try to address some of these short-term improvements to address some community concerns along Fremont Avenue and along Huntington Drive after meeting some of the residents on site and having some community meetings with the mayor as well and some city council members and talking to some of the residents from Huntington Drive and Fair Oaks. They provide a lot of feedback. So we came up with some short-term improvements for those two corridors to try to alleviate some of their concerns. At the same time, we kind of advised them and kept them abreast of this long-term project that we had funding for. More or less about in the last 2 years, the city of South Pasadena received two grants. One of them was a Measure R grant. So it was a reallocation of the Interstate 710 funds where the city received approximately $10 million with $1.1 million currently that is phased in. And this specific grant prioritizes intelligent transportation systems along the entire corridor of Fremont Avenue and Huntington Drive. And then we also received the Measure M Active Transportation grant from LA Metro. That was approximately $6 million. So that prioritized active transportation with a focus on pedestrian improvement, bike improvements, bus improvements, bus shelters, bike lanes, and other pedestrian enhancements and median improvements and crosswalk enhancements for Huntington Drive again, and also Fremont Avenue. But with these funding agreements, what they didn't cover is the planning phase. So the total $16 million, these funding agreements do not cover any of the planning efforts that we're trying to do as this first step of the planning process.
I'm sorry, if I can interrupt you, you said three grants, so Measure R, Measure N. 10 million Measure R.
I meant to say two grants.
Oh, two grants.
Thank Measure you. M and Measure R. So just to this last month, we've been working on a scope with the consultant to a design group. And we've been developing a task order and working with their team to finalize that task order. And we kind of finalize that. And we're going to take that item to council. So part of that scope is going to include four different phases. So what we're trying to do for this project is a charrette. It's a multi-day community engagement event where different stakeholders come out and decision makers are also welcome to come alongside different experts with landscapers, engineers, and different people coming out to create and try to resolve some of the issues that are present here at Fremont and Huntington Drive. So part of the scope, like I mentioned, it includes four different steps. The first initial step includes preparation where we coordinate and we provide any city documents over to the consultant so they can initiate their research. That includes general plan, the downtown specific plan, any plans that are relevant that they could use to begin the charrette process, some background information and research, Sweater's data, collision data, any transportation network information that we can provide them. We're starting to collect that information so then we can transition it over to the consultant. So the next steps after that includes a discovery phase. It also includes two different design charrettes phases and the final step, which is a documentation phase. So after the preparation, when the consultant receives all this information, we begin the discovery and site visit, which would be the initial day where the consultant comes on site and they get a tour of the different corridors, Fremont Avenue, as well as Huntington Drive. And one thing that I forgot to mention as well is that part of this the scope of work, we're also including Fair Oaks Avenue, just because it's also a major arteria in the city. And we thought it was crucial to include this corridor just to kind of design a more balanced distribution of traffic and enhance connectivity through the different, for the three corridors that we have planned for. So just going back to the discovery and the site visit. So during this initial step, they'll conduct a map of review of issues, identify goals and objective that they're trying to do for the charrette. We'll finalize a charrette schedule, which is scheduled to begin sometime in the fall of 2023. At that same day, after they do conduct their site visit, they'll have a community meeting at the end of the day where the community will be invited. They'll go over the objectives and the goals and present the next steps of the charrette process. So for that first initial design charrette, it's kind of a 4-day process, which the first day again is the discovery and the site visit. And the next 3 days is when they begin to develop starter ideas and identify what they identify in the discovery session. They vet through each of these issues. At the same time, we ask that they also be part of an MTIC meeting for those people that may not be able to attend any of the charrette design process in person. We ask them to also facilitate an MTIC meeting where the public can also provide comment so they can record that as well. So during this initial phase, it would also consist of different stakeholder meetings for the city. So the city and the consultant will work together to identify different key stakeholders throughout the city so they can conduct one-on-one interviews with them, or they can conduct group meetings with them, doing one-on-one and having a designer, the charrette lead and engineer be part of that process and documenting all of this information from table to table. After that first session that happens, the consultant leaves for about 4 weeks. Then they come back for to conduct the second design charrette, where the ideas are kind of more refined on the preferred options. They develop concept plans with for the three different corridors, and at the same time they meet with the necessary stakeholders once again. They have a pin-up session and meet up with city officials, which also the key stakeholders also include commissioners, city council members, and any other members that we identify that need to be part of the charrette process. On the fourth day of that design charrette meeting, they kind of finalize their products and hold the final stakeholder meeting before leaving, so they present their recommendations and items that they have as a preliminary. And then finally, once they finalize all of that, they go back and it's the documentation phase, which would be the fourth step. where they document and create three different recommendation plans for each of the three different corridors for Fremont, Huntington Drive. And they provide drawings and functional cross sections and drawings to make this feasible so we can transition to the next phase after that. So this whole design charrette process is estimated to take about 3 months, sometime in the fall. After we take this item over to, the task order to council tomorrow, if it is finalized, then we'll circle back with the consultant, get the final signatures, and develop a time schedule for the charrette. But we'll mark off the calendars because once we identify the dates, it might be a little bit difficult to change some of those dates. So we'll be in constant communication with the commission and different stakeholders and just communicating to them when those meetings are going to be occurring in the fall. So that's pretty much it. That's kind of like an overview of what we're planning on presenting over to the council. So we just wanted to bring this item to you guys to give you an update on what's going on with this planning phase.
Thank you, Mr. Pena. I guess we'll turn it over for questions. Or should I ask, do we have any public comment on this item? Let's go ahead.
We do have a public comment.
Okay. So this is on the Fair Oaks and Huntington information report. So
yes. Andrea Fox, is your public comment on item two?
Yes, but just to clarify, it's actually Brandon instead of Andrew who's going to be speaking. But you just said Fair Oaks and Huntington. I think you mean Fremont and Huntington. Is that correct?
Fremont and Huntington.
Yeah, not three corridors.
Yeah.
Got it. It is about that. And I just wanted to thank David for his presentation. And just some of you on the commission have heard about our frustration over time. I think we're on the right path. Finally, after a few years of inaction, and I just want to say that we've been working with the city manager now, the mayor, Public Works, with Ted and David, and if we can keep to those timelines, that's ideal, because something that I don't think we can lose track of is that the grant money, the $6.1 million specifically, needs to be spent in the next 2 years. And so we just need this construction to happen. We do think that the $16 million grant in grants is a once in a lifetime opportunity for this street that's been neglected for several decades. So anyway, we just want to again thank them, and we look forward to working with them throughout this process.
Thank you for your public comment. With that, I'll turn it over to commissioners for questions. We'll start with maybe 5 minutes per commissioner, and then we can circle back around. Who would like to kick us off?
You want me to start?
Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you to the Foxes and Brandon for your input. And I know their street's been waiting patiently for a long time for attention. So hopefully we're moving in the right direction. Thank you to David for your presentation. Questions? I'll just go one by one. So my first was timeline. You mentioned, I think I have it right, that this would, assuming it's approved tomorrow night, it would start this fall, like with step one. Is that right?
Correct.
And then it's a 3-month charrette process.
Yes.
And then documentation.
Yes.
So the all in, like if it's starting in the fall of 2023, when would you expect all of these steps to be complete, including the documentation?
I think it's going to be within a 3-month period, more or less, and the discussions that we have with the consultant, including the documentation that includes the travel and the in between each phase.
So by the end of the year ish?
Yes. That,
okay.
Can I add one thing to that, David? So we want to schedule the charrette process in the fall. Some of the discovery would start right away in terms of like giving the consultant the information they need. So it's not like the project has is approved tomorrow night and then sits for some time.
Yeah.
That initial work has to be done first over the summer.
Okay. Great. Thank you, Ted. The next question I had, how does this process here interact with the sort of greater $30 million+ new 110 on-ramp loop ramp concept. Is that a separate project and separate process, or is that somehow considered as part of this? Or would that be part of these discussions?
So yes and no. So that project, separate funding, the $10 million for this project, Fremont Huntington, of the $16 million. So as David mentioned, there's two funding sources. There's a $6 million source and a $10 million source. That $10 million is out of the $80 million Measure R MIP funding, which the remainder of that $80 million is for that loop ramp project. Now, as far as this project goes, it certainly needs to consider the impacts of that ramp project, but this planning process won't go as so far as to, do any sort of, it won't be spending a whole lot of time on that ramp project other than how that fits into the global picture for the planning process.
Okay.
Now we will touch on that project on our project status report, because we do have some moving parts on that as well, which will, our priorities are these CIP projects. We want to bring Fremont Huntington first, and then that will follow as the initial steps for that project. But so there is a tie-in, but
I got it.
I can't think of the word, but you know what I mean.
No, understood. Yeah. Thank you. No, that's helpful. I think it's around, it's 430,000 and change for it that's proposed for this project process task. Where would that come from?
Sure. So as David mentioned, the $16 million does not allot for this sort of preliminary planning work. Now, a very small part of that is because it wasn't included in the original funding request. But even if it had been, there's limitations in those funding rules about what you can spend on this type of planning work. Now, the city has a great deal of local Measure M and Measure R money that it accrues from the regular, it's a regular allotment from Metro every year. In fact, there was over $1 million that was lapsing as of this past June, and we acted with Metro to capture that money and lock it into a capital reserve agreement so that we could use that funding in future street repairs. And so another thing we'll bring into council is that capital reserve agreement. So there is money that can be spent out of our local Measure M and Measure R funding that is completely apart from these fund sources, which are Measure M MAT special funds and Measure R MIP special funds. Just quickly, Measure M has three types of funds. There's the Measure M we're talking about here tonight, MAT. There's our local Measure M money. And then there's the Measure M MSP money that you're all very familiar with, which is our Measure M project list that we evaluate every 2 years.
That's the one associated with the Joint Powers Authority and such.
Exactly, right? Yeah. And so to answer your question, the city has groups of projects that it's basically appropriated for this local Measure M and Measure R money. We've recently reevaluated those projects, and a former group of staff had set aside, I want to say like $600,000 in total for other work that was planning work along Fair Oaks. And I don't know if the intent was in lieu of the ramp project, but there was some sort of planning assessment study that was going to be done. So we're releasing that money from that obligation, and we'll be using part of that for this process.
Okay, great. Thank you. No, that's very helpful. Fair Oaks, it's not part of it, but it's part of it. So I just want to get a sense of, will the result of this process be that there will be some proposals for Fair Oaks, or no, whatever is proposed as part of this, through this process, is the focus is Fremont and Huntington?
Sure. Maybe you want to start with the efficiency, and then I can talk about like project over, like.
Yeah. So as mentioned earlier, so the funding agreements, the Measure R and the Measure M, so they specifically call out or cover Huntington Drive, the entire corridor in the city boundaries, and Fremont Avenue. There is no funding for Fair Oaks per se, but just given that it is a major arterial, and we are embarking on a comprehensive plan for the city, a capital improvement project, we felt that it was necessary to include Fair Oaks as part of this planning effort, just so we can have a more, you know, balanced design and distribution of traffic once we analyze that and present that. Now, it doesn't necessarily mean that we have the funding source for it, but since we are doing it at this point, this might be the time to actually do it, to do that initial planning phase of it. Whether we transition over to the construction for anything on Fair Oaks would be something for a later discussion.
And I'll add to that. Yep. So as you know, we have a project along Fair Oaks right now. The scope is very specific to ITS improvements and ADA improvements. So we're limited in terms of what we can do with that Rogan project. But as David mentioned, you know, in doing a comprehensive this comprehensive planning work, it makes sense to include Fair Oaks now for multiple reasons. First of all, the cost efficiency of doing the planning effort and bringing all these folks together and doing this all at once, because and also having this Rogan project happen at the same time, any sorts of improvements that we identify that are related to ADA and or ITS improvements can be fed into this Rogan project at this time. The Rogan project right now is at the environmental stage. We're not allowed to move into like later design work with the Rogan project until we get Caltrans's approval of that environmental phase. So there's still time to understand other things that we could do on Fair Oaks. Now, with that said, since we're only biting off, you know, intersection by intersection in terms of ADA improvements on Fair Oaks and the ITS improvements, we expect there will be more to do on Fair Oaks at a later time. This planning process sets us up in a good position to understand what those things could be and pursue additional funding sources for them moving forward. Because, you know, Fair Oaks has got a lot of opportunities, a lot of active transportation opportunity there. You know, there's a lot of regional impact that Fair Oaks could have that would be, you know, a good, you know, as I mentioned, as we're going to talk about later, we were awarded a number of HSIP projects along at Fremont and Huntington locations, particularly because of their influence in highway safety. So, you know, that sets us up for a good standing to try to receive additional money for Fair Oaks in the future. So the answer in general is yes. Like, we're targeting both the current work that could be connected to the Rogan project and also a future project.
Great. All right. Thank you, Ted. Thank you, David.
Thank you, Commissioner Iverson. And we'll come back to you if you have more questions. Commissioner Fisher?
Thank you. So as I understand it, this is just for the planning part of the Huntington-Fremont corridor to get to acquaint the public with it, to get their feedback, to get ideas and such, to make sure that they're aware of the project.
Sure.
Now, yeah. Then will there be another contract and another phase of this project that covers more of the engineering, that defines where there are bottlenecks, where there are safety problems, where there are speeding issues, et cetera?
Absolutely. And that's what the funding will cover, starting with PA and ED, project approval environmental document. So we'll have to go through that phase, which of course include those types of analysis, the preliminary engineering work, the actual design and modeling. There's ITS components in the funding so that, you know, as you know, there's system evaluation work that has to be done at that level. All the phases of transportation design and construction work you expect are still programmed into that $6 million. This is essentially an early outreach phase, which we feel is very appropriate for this community and for this breadth of a project, so that we can not just do that community SHRET process, but bring in all this other information that should influence this project. David mentioned just a few documents to name as far as planning documents go.
But as you all know, in your history with the city, there are a lot of ideas and, you know, even policy items as to what should be done on these corridors. And that really should be incorporated into this early work to gather all this information together. The idea is that when this is complete, we can move right into that project approval environmental document phase.
Okay. And then what would be the time frame for that? And would there be a different firm that would handle those aspects, the engineering aspects?
I'm going to take that one. As the Foxes had mentioned, we are on a timeline for that. The two funding sources have project schedules. The Measure R project schedule started some time ago and has to be reset with this process. The Measure M funding agreement was more recently executed, and so that clock is already ticking. Now, there is some flex in the schedule as we move through it, just like any project, but we still want to keep as close to the schedule as possible. And so the project completion is supposed to take about 3 years in total, and we're already into that timeline. So that's what we're expecting, is we would like this process done by the end of the year so that we are moving into the next phases at early 2024.
Thank you.
Commissioner Hughes, Vice Chair Hughes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you both very much for this presentation. Lots of good information. To kind of dovetail on what Commissioner Abelson said, what kind of tools will they bring to the charrettes to get people talking about concepts? Because a lot of times you need to have visuals. And going back a ways, there was, and I think I will dovetail onto the question about the Fair Oaks connection, because at one point there was discussion about putting road condition electronic signage along the northern route of Fremont. So potentially when you hit Fremont and Huntington, you would be persuaded through signs or even looking at, I'm going to say, two right-hand turn lanes to get traffic off of the residential into Fremont, to get them to go right, to get them to Fair Oaks, so that the electronic signage would say, you know, route from here to Pasadena, you know, border on Fair Oaks, 10 minutes or whatever it might be. So what kind of tools or elements can we show people conceptually that so that when we have the open charrette discussions that can spur those kind of discussions, ideas, et cetera. So what are we going to show them? What are we going to bring and talk about? Also, have we collaborated and made our desires known to our fellow neighboring cities? Because right now, if you go to the new construction that was done in unincorporated on Huntington Drive, you come from San Marino, and all of a sudden there's a bike lane that just appears, and lots of new striping, configuration, turns, parking delineations, striping out of nowhere, and then it stops again when you get further into Arcadia. So want to make sure if we can collaborate with the city of Alhambra, the city of San Marino, the city of Pasadena. So if we're going north and we say we're going to go up at Columbia, then again, we've been talking about the configurations up at Columbia and Fremont and improvements there. And then at the south side, what do we need to do? And how do we make it all work so we're all in collaboration? We don't have fits and starts of bike lanes, et cetera, which brings me to, I'm assuming we're going to be providing the most up-to-date bike plan along with the general plan and the downtown specific as part of the discussion as to how these bike lanes might be configured based on the concepts of the bike plan. Also for accessibility for the charrettes, are they only going to be in person, or will there be access for a Zoom attendance or ADA considerations, et cetera? So those are my questions.
Sure. I'm going to try to take those one at a time. And if I falter, please just remind me of the question. And then maybe David, you could address some of the tools and some of the processes that the consultant will use in the shred. So as far as our neighboring cities go, the answer is yes. we've already spoken to Pasadena quite at length about this process and like where they would come in for that type of that discussion. David has made the connections to LA, which is a terrific timing with regard to the projects and the plans they have along Huntington, and might be able to elaborate a little bit on that. We're working on our connections with Alhambra. That was what we had talked about at our last meeting, certainly absolutely including them in this process. And some of the San Marino staff is new. And so we've recently just tried to make a connection with them, and we think we'll be successful in talking about that, because certainly the regional perspective is important when considering how all this stuff fits together. Now, with regard to accessibility, the plan is to hold these sessions at the library community room, which you feel is, you know, the appropriate place in town that can handle the you know, the variety of types of people that will want to join us there. We do plan on holding part of this at an MTech meeting also, which would provide this as a forum and also that connectivity. We don't have that type of connectivity at the library, so we kind of have to just try to make it work with regard to the inclusiveness of everything. That's one nice thing about starting this process now, is that, as David mentioned, we can put this on the schedule and try to get as many stakeholders involved as possible with enough advance notice. I'm trying to remember back, besides the tool question, what was your part B of
what kind of
question
tools
one?
Are we going to show? Sure. What will they bring to, you know, spur the conversation and conceptualize?
So part of the task order, like I had mentioned earlier, is the first phase is the preparation phase, where we provide any documents that are necessary for the consultant to review, get familiar with the process. So on their first day on the discovery and site visit, they don't necessarily come empty-handed, but they already come with visuals, GIS maps, drawings, lists of particular issues, graphics that they can provide. So they have a base that they can bring on the day of. As the community design charrette progresses, there's going to be an iteration where there's going to be more graphics and visuals available for the public to see. And that's part of the conversation we have with the consultant, to engage the community in a way that this is very engaging and graphical. And there's a communication that it's has short-term communication, where there's loops of quick turnaround, and they can incorporate comments made by the by key stakeholders. So part of that includes that, just ongoing dialogue with them, and including a lot of visual graphics to make it more understanding for the public.
So you'll have examples of photos of different configurations, like different bike lane configurations and or protected bike lanes versus protected parking, different ways that people understand the tools and the execution. Options.
Yeah, and that's part of the goals and objectives of what, you know, the city and the community wants, and setting the tone at the initial stage and presenting some of those options, and having different people from different backgrounds, engineers, designers, landscapers, to present those options, see what is feasible as well, and presenting some of these options that you mentioned, as, you know, different type of bike lanes, you know, different pedestrian crossings, you know, what's feasible as well.
And the last question I have is, has there been consideration at all about addressing the landscape medians as an option of removing and then reconfiguring everything?
Yes, you know, anything could be on the table here. I mean, this scope is intended to try to gather all of these issues, particularly in the active transportation area. And so it's not necessarily that we would come out with a solution to say, we need to remove this median here. That might be for a later part phase of the project. It's that, like, you know, I'll just give an example. We were talking to one of our other consultants today. It actually happens to be a city resident, and we were talking about this project, and they gave us, like, you know, I can't get from
this place to this place on my bike because of this happening. And we have, you know, a designer that we hire or our city staff are not going to have that type of knowledge. Those are the types of problems we're trying to solve. We have to prioritize them because we certainly can't solve every problem with the funding that we have. But so to your comment, like if that is causing a problem for somebody and we don't recognize what that problem is, that would certainly come up in this planning phase. Now, if there's an engineering issue with that median, we would expect that to come up in a later phase. But in particular, this funding covers Fremont and Huntington, but also covers the intersection of Huntington and Fair Oaks, which right. is, you know, complicated, and there's many medians right. there.
Because there's been some cities have been looking at kind of what we have with the large landscape medians and how it's, you know, green space that's inaccessible to people because it's in the middle of the street. But it's like reconfiguring, because they did this, I forget what city, where they took that all out and reconfigured and created like the parklets and the side and moved everything so that you then had accessible parklet green spaces that people could enjoy as opposed to the green space in the middle of the street.
It's an interesting idea. Absolutely. Yeah. And it's one that I don't think I've considered that. I think of it. I mean, from an engineer perspective, we were looking to see if we could infiltrate water into that median to get it back into the groundwater system. But yeah, I mean, there's lots of different configurations. And as our public commenter said, this amount of money is a once in a lifetime opportunity. We want to make sure that we get enough community involvement and get this planning phase done correctly so that when we, you know, we don't necessarily have regrets about the project, that we did the best that we could.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Vice Chair Hughes. I think my question was largely around the intersectionality with the Fair Oaks project. And it sounds like the $16 million, at least for now, is Fremont and Huntington. And then Fair Oaks will be included in this planning effort, but anything on Fair Oaks will need to be funded from a separate funding source or...
With the exception of what we have funded already, which is ADA and ATS, and then also the Revalia, you know, Fair Oaks area ramp.
Okay. Project. Okay. Yeah. And I think this planning process is important. You know, you say $16 million is a once in a lifetime or once in, I don't know.
Once in a
generation. I think it's going to go pretty, I think it's going to be spent pretty quickly.
Yeah.
You know, I think these are all streets that are pretty in a state of disrepair, that once you really get into there, it's, you know, I think the money's going to go pretty quick, especially, if we're removing medians, and we'll need to start looking at some other.
And that's a good point, because, you know, the prioritization of what's important is really a key here. You know, you could balloon and balloon and balloon and try to do everything under the sun, but until you really narrow down what the community really needs, you got to focus. So,
yeah. So will, will any sort of crash data be incorporated into this initial work?
This initial work isn't about modeling necessarily. That would come at a later phase.
Okay, but even just kind of informing some of the
recommendations. Oh, I think it could.
Like collision data?
Yes.
You know.
Yeah, that could be included as far as understanding the inputs. But we don't have any particular synchro modeling work being done.
Right. I'm just specifically talking about collisions because, you know, if you start perceived safety and real safety are sometimes two very different things. And
yeah, absolutely.
Go out to the field and have the data to talk about. Otherwise, you know.
Yeah. And, you know, even in our conversations with the families on Fremont, they've pointed out particular accident prone zones because of a particular situation. That's the, you know, and you talk to the community members, they'll point to what accidents have occurred.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, part of that effort is determining the cause of that and is there something that can be done about it? You know, so that is part of that effort. Yeah.
Will you help me understand, after this is over, what I will have in my hands or what you will have in your hands that allows you to move forward into the next phase?
Our hope is that we have a document for each corridor that summarizes the charrette process, the ideas, some level of prioritization, or, you know, I would call it feasibility, but there's a big spectrum of what that is. We'll be getting a lot of great ideas. We'll be getting a lot of ideas that might not be feasible or appropriate.
And so an initial pass on that type of information. So our thought is that we have several documents for the quarters at the end of this process that we can use in the procurement process to select the project approval environmental document, perhaps preliminary design consultant to move into the actual project. Because for us, right now, developing that, so let's just call it an RFP, would be very difficult for us to define what the project is. Mm-hmm. So we have our guidance right now is a couple paragraphs in a funding agreement that are very overarching about all the possible things this project could cover. And it doesn't direct us specifically about what should be actually designed.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, will this include some sort of preliminary engineering? And I mean, just very nascent. Here's a conceptual plan. You know, if you put in a bike lane, you're going to have to remove parking or you're going to have to widen or do whatever. Like, I think some sort of.
Yeah. As David had mentioned, like there's site visits programmed into it. There's actual evaluation of the, you know, let's say the, you know, the site geometrics mm-hmm. to say like what's feasible here. And so, you know, it is a conceptual design at the end. You have a conceptual design, but it is just that it has not been formally vetted through, you know, the iterative design process as a starting point.
Okay.
Yeah.
And will this also include, you know, I think sometimes the most controversial thing can be parking, you know, and it's like everyone wants everything, but if you lose 3 parking spots, you know, I could give you $1 million as long as, you know, you're not taking away parking.
Yeah.
Like, are they going to, will this also include like an analysis of the potential parking?
The answer is yes. I don't know how far that analysis would go in terms of, say doing a parking study to determine what parking is necessary or, you know, what are the different options as far as an aggressive, you know, aggressive removal of parking versus maintaining the status quo. We, you know, we expect to get a lot of feedback on parking from community members. We already do. I think this project will, because it's looking at site geometrics and things like that, will try to, offer up some ideas on solutions for parking or how to add things like, you know, bike lanes or enhanced pedestrian facilities and not impact parking. I think at the end of the day, the consultant will probably give us like what the community's feedback on parking is compared to other priorities. So, okay. You know, this won't be the silver bullet.
Right.
This will be our,
I guess I'm asking that because some of those issues are, you know, down the line they're going to be issues that kind of come up. So it's better to kind of have that.
Yeah, that's one of the documents that I was kind of looking, making sure we identify and we definitely convey it to the consultant and get the part of the municipal code that applies to parking as it relates to Fremont and Huntington Drive. So that's part of that initial step that where we collect that information. And so they are aware when they do conduct that site visit and when they're having those discussions with the public that they are, you know, intimately familiar with what's going on in the city as it relates to parking.
Thank you. And just 2 quick questions. I assume the businesses are a stakeholder group, in particular the ones at Fremont and Huntington. This will include some outreach to them.
Absolutely, okay. Yeah.
And lastly, are there any other, I'm just trying to think if there are any other, because like you said, we're going to the community, we're ringing the bell, we are talking about Fair Oaks. Are there any other efforts along these streets that we should be talking about? You know, you like Measure W or are there any art initiatives happening or any like
there's a lot replanting, you know, as you the know. As the general as the downtown specific plan gets published underway, you'll see there's a thought towards artistic crosswalk implementation mm-hmm. in there. We have our capital improvement program, which includes, yes, infiltration projects. We have one that's planned along Huntington that we've been trying to get funding for a couple of years. That's why this effort is basically, you know, a gathering of all this information, and it's not going to solve all these issues, but it's at least the left hand talking to the right hand in that respect.
Thank you, Ted. Any other questions? Commissioner Abelson? We'll start, sorry.
Thank you. Just a few more questions. I'm just trying to get an understanding of, I guess obviously we're invited to participate in the charrettes. Officially and formally, what is this commission's involvement in this process? I think David mentioned that the consultant will be coming to one of our meetings. I just want to get a better understanding of how we sort of, what part we play, if any.
Yes. Sure. I think our thought was that, again, to Chair Dunlap's comment, and actually it was a Vice Chair Hughes that brought it up about accessibility. We thought that accessibility, you know, this is really our only venue where we're actually able to do like a Zoom connected meeting. So that was one aspect of ensuring that there was an MTech forum, was that we were trying to be as inclusive as possible. And, you know, for all the efforts that we'll do to outreach and try to get people at the in-person sessions, if there's anywhere that someone's going to go to voice their opinion about transportation matters, it would be here. So that's one aspect of that. As far as what we'll be asking the commission to do, we don't really have that clarified yet. I think our intent was to tie this effort back to the commission review process. I don't know that we'll ask for a recommendation or if it will just be a presentation of where we are so far, or maybe we'll be a little further along. It's a very good question. We don't think we have that part figured out yet. That was something that we added to the scope of the work because we wanted, like I said, that connectivity, that tie into the commission's work plan. We wanted to make that connection. So we have to, it would be helpful if you had feedback on what you don't have to do it tonight, but what the commission's role could be in this process, what you envision it to be. We just wanted some sort of connection there.
Okay. All right. Thank you. And this sort of leads into the next question, which is, so the way I understand it, there'll be these charrettes, and then there'll be these final reports, I guess, in essentially listing proposals for each street, for each of the, I guess, the two streets. Does that sound right? Based on these meetings and the input from the community, here's the list of projects that we intend, with which we intend to move forward. Is that a fair?
I think that it might not necessarily go that far as a project recommendation. It'll probably give us the greatest breadth of a consensus conceptual idea that's feasible. Meaning like, you know, this is the majority of what the community is envisioning for this, what they would like to see. And there's, because we have professionals doing it, it's not, you know, a crayon drawing of something that's not impossible, that's impossible to build. It's more like, you know, something that is conceptual, but is rooted in the space that we have and what the community would like, and also a summarization of the SHRET process. It'll be, we will take that to, bring that to the next step, which is going to have to refine that, prioritize based on, we'll get some of the prioritization done on the budget with this process, but there will be a refinement of that information to move into the actual project phase, okay. If that makes sense. Okay. I don't think it won't basically be, you know, I wouldn't envision it as one of our much smaller scope projects where we hire a consultant to take a look at a specifically designed or specific problem, offer up design solutions with a budget so that we can implement them. This is a much, much more high level process so that we can
Because as the commission mentioned, for many other projects, you don't necessarily do this much at this phase. You'll get into the, you know, you'll define the project area. You'll have a consultant come in and start to look at data and problems and then suggest solutions. What we're trying to do here is sort of preempt that process a little bit by already connecting with the public and the issues that they see, so that those get prioritized in that first design phase.
Okay. And so is there going to be, and maybe because it's conceptual and high level, there's not much of that at this point, but is there going to be some level of filtering or analysis that the consultant does? You know, let's say Charette 1 happens, get all kinds of interesting ideas from the community, some of which are feasible, some of which aren't, right? So is the consultant going to say, okay, well, these are the things based on what we've heard from the community that we think are feasible or could move forward, and maybe not these things? Or is that at some other stage or
process? I'd argue that that is what we're trying to do. I mean, the reason you're having a consultant who's experiencing like an urban planning effort is to filter that level.
Okay.
What we're hoping is that in that process, we can engage with those community members that say have the ideas that are feasible versus the ideas that are not feasible, and explain why they are one or the other. Because what we don't want to do is have an adversarial design process later on where we're already deeper into the design and someone says, you should have done this, why didn't you do that? And then we're making that argument that that's not feasible when we, you know, maybe didn't even look at it. So it's, you know, we're trying to make sure that this is about consensus building so the projects can move forward smoothly.
Okay. Understood. Last question. So it's funny. I looked at the report and I saw the name Tool Design Group, and it didn't specifically click. And then I looked further and I see that it's Ian Lockwood. Okay. So am I remembering correctly that he or his firm were the ones involved in designing the Fair Oaks bulb outs and or the original Fremont traffic calming plan? Then I know he or his firm were involved.
I believe they're involved in the 2009 Fremont calming study. I don't necessarily think they were involved in the design of the bulb outs. I know that they, I understand that he probably with another firm produced a design review of the bulb outs.
Oh, that may be what we're calling.
But yes, that's so, you know, we've been engaging with this consultant for some time. Even though the scope work has been recent, the idea for this work goes back a long ways. And the, you know, work to actually set up a contract with the consultant to go through this planning process has been in the works for a while. So we're pretty confident that this is the right firm to do what we're trying to accomplish here. Like I said, this is kind of set apart from, say, one of our on-call traffic engineering firms where we would, you know, want to hand them a problem and try to find a solution or give us a study. This is really in the planning area, not the engineering area, even though we do have some engineering, you know, staff that are trained and involved in the process.
So we have a master agreement with Tool, right?
Yes.
And this is one of the tasks.
This would be a task order. Yes.
Okay. And are there other tasks that
we haven't asked them about it? This is the first and only task order that we have with them at the moment. Yeah.
Okay. I promise this is the last one. Sorry, Kim.
That's okay.
Documentation's produced, distilling everything that went on through this process. Is there some decision point at that point that, like, you go to city council with these reports and say approve them or not, or to us for recommendations, or no, you get these reports as part of this, and then you move on to the next phase? I'm trying to get a sense.
And our assumption that there would not be an approval process. We would certainly want to, you know, we'll probably have multiple updates on this project with council to keep them informed about what's going on. But the next approval with council will probably be as we, you know,
start to work with the funding or start you know, getting on another consultant to do some of the actual, the later phase project work. So yeah, it's not, there's nothing really that needs to be adopted here. It's conceptual design. We're not going to ask even of MTEC to, you know, give us buy-in on that. It's the documents are intended to be, a really well vetted starting point for that, for the Fremont Huntington design.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Commissioner Hughes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a quick question. One of the things that has been discussed a lot for the region is in regards to climate change and bus transportation and bus shelters and shade. Is that something that could be part of this? Because there is a lot of bus activity on Huntington, and there isn't a lot of structural shade. We have some on Fair Oaks, but we don't have a lot on Huntington. And I'm wondering if that's a component that people might be interested in, because there's a lot of complaints, particularly in summer when people are out waiting in the hot sun and there's nothing. So I don't know if that's an element that could be part of the consideration for the improvements, because if that's another form of transportation we would like to encourage.
Absolutely. I think the Measure M funding agreement that we have does call out for specific improvements to some of the bus shelters along Huntington Drive. So there is that part incorporated, and any of the different stakeholders that does attend is more than welcome to offer some of these suggestions as well, because it is within the scope of our funding agreement, and there is funding for it as well for those type of improvements.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Commissioner Fisher.
What is informed consent, as you showed in this report?
I would define that as, you know, you're building a consensus, but you're building it in a way that you're communicating with people things they need to know in order for them to make that decision. So in other words, we talked about people offering ideas that are either feasible or infeasible. I think if they're informed about what you're trying to accomplish and you're informed about why something is feasible or feasible, you're more likely to get their consensus about, you know, what you're proposing, because they know more. You know, we had this conversation all the time. You know, it comes up to say, people, why don't you just go do this? And then once you tell them, well, you know, there's restrictions on this, or there's a regulatory issue, or, you know, that's not feasible from a constructability standpoint, that information, I think, helps form the consensus of like, okay, you know, hopefully their response is, I understand why you can't do that. What I'm trying to accomplish is, this is my problem. What would you do about it? So that's what we're trying to accomplish. I think that's what that term is implying.
Okay, thank you. It sounds as if the consultant will get input, show sketches, list ideas and such, and that will happen before you've had the engineering analysis that might identify what you need to do to relieve congestion or to improve pedestrian safety or to lower speeding at a location. So how do those later engineering ideas get incorporated into the project if it wasn't discussed during this charrette phase of the project?
Well, you know, I think the idea here is that the community members won't necessarily have the perspective of the engineering design process and all that work that has to happen to accomplish what you're saying. What we're trying to gather from those community members is, you know, a good example is, like I mentioned earlier, about, you know, bike facilities, where and when. And to answer Vice Chair Hughes' earlier question, is the one I missed, the bike plan will be included as one of those documents. So I think maybe to better answer your question is, when we get into, let's say, the environmental analysis of a traffic pattern, or, you know, the engineering analysis of collision data and how that impacts the design of an intersection,
that will come up later on in the project. And, you know, it's possible that it could conflict with conceptual design that was brought up by the community, and we'll have to resolve that at that time. But we think that in this particular project, with its really broad, very large scope, it's a better approach to gather community ideas and then go through the design process to refine those into something that we can actually build, versus going directly to the design process, accessing the data, and offering up a engineered solution and trying to get the community to buy into it, and trying to defend it in a way where it might be in contrast to their ideas, versus, you know, we think it's might be a better project if we can gather those ideas first and then move into the design and modify those ideas while continuing to communicate with the people who presented those ideas and why we had to modify them.
Yeah, I just hope that it would be clear during the charrette planning phase of the project that that the ideas that we get and receive are those that will inform the process, but will not necessarily mandate the features of the project.
I think that comes down to explaining the design process. You know, we typically take the approach of a 30-60-90 design, where it's 30%, 60%, 90%. And the 90% design could really look a lot different than what we initially started with because of all the other, you know, factors that come into play. So I think we agree with what you're saying. I think that really comes down to informing the public about how this process will work. And I think there's a lot of I think there will be a lot of you know, it'll be helpful to do that process early on versus trying to get buy-in on, say, like a 60% design.
Okay, thank you.
Any last questions? All right, I'll thank you. Thanks, Public Works staff, for providing this informational report. We'll follow the council meeting tomorrow night to see how they, what questions they have and how they act, and look forward to the updates as this progresses. Thank you. And with that, I will go to our next item, which is project status updates with Public Works Director Gerber. It is my goal that this meeting be under 2 hours, so I will limit this item to 30 minutes if we can get through all of our questions in under 30 minutes. Director Gerber.
Thank you, Chair Dunlap. And I understand that goal. I guess I'll just add that, you know, in the interest of that time and the purpose of the report, we do have a lot of updates. I'm going to share some of the highlighted updates with you tonight. For the items that don't have a significant update, happy to answer questions on them, but if we have listed as not a significant update, we really don't have anything really new to share on that, on those items. So as far as our highlighted items, I do have one thing on that. Do you mind opening the street PDF on the, not the slow streets one. It's the PDF, the other one. Yes, the map. Perfect. Okay, so on our street improvements project, as you recall, we have split the projects for this year into four groups. What you see on this map, and I know I'm bringing this because this is something that the commission wanted to discuss. So this is kind of the first of several updates. When we get that map back up, you'll see that we've got some green streets and some orange streets. These are what I would call, these are the reconstruction projects, our actual CIP bid, correcting street base, recompacting curb and gutter, and in some case sidewalk repair locations for what we expect to complete in 2023 in green, and what we expect to complete in 2024 in orange. I know it's difficult to see.
this aligns with what you already are familiar with as the 2018-19 and the 2019-20 street improvement projects. So this is essentially, the green is the first bid package that's going out. It's Monterey Road from the West City limits to Pasadena Avenue. It's Sterling Place, east of Grand Avenue. Forest, just north of Mission Street, that's that little green one on the left, and then Alta Vista in the hillside from Indiana to Oakcrest. That's the first bid package. The next one we're working on is the orange set, which is, I think it's like Maple, Pine, Oneonta Knoll, I think it's Mill and Edgewood, Arroyo Verde, and then as a separate effort, the Mission Pasadena Arroyo intersection, sort of a more complicated reconfiguration. This map does not include resurfacing projects, slurry treatments, and Cape Seal treatments that we're also planning to do this year. The reason why is because even though we have that list and we've discussed that list here at commission, emphasis on the word may, that may change based on funding, current condition, you know, cost benefit. And that we will discuss that with you. We'll bring it forward to you. We're just not ready for that yet. And our efforts are focused on getting these bid projects done because it's a lot more complicated. These are plan sets, you know, heavy construction work. Whereas those other slurry projects, we expect to be done with more simple specification and something that we can do as a maintenance item versus like a very large CIP project. So just want to give you some background on that. We're working on this, we'll keep you posted. We do have a groundbreaking event that we're putting on next Tuesday, and everyone is more than welcome to join us. It's gonna be on Sterling Place where one of the projects is occurring Tuesday morning, the 25th at 10 a.m. And the idea there is to also share this information, you know, just talk about a little bit about the streets and just give a, you know, it's basically a, you know, a celebratory start to this process for the year. No, if there's no questions about that one, I'll move on to the next one.
I guess we can go through questions.
Yeah. I'm sorry.
The Sterling Place, is it going to be at the cul-de-sac end?
Yeah,
or
exactly.
At the Grand Avenue?
Cul-de-sac side. Thank you. Okay. Yeah, for asking.
Any questions, Commissioner? Vice Chair Hughes?
Thank you, Ted. This is exciting. Could you give us this in a list?
Yeah, absolutely.
In more detail, because I'm looking at the 2018-20, you know, want to make sure what's covered, not covered, and if there's any holes.
Yeah, and at a later meeting, a later item, we'll give you that analysis to cover that, and I know that's what we're looking for. I can give you the list. This list is also in the SB1 list that we submitted in our June 21st meeting, but I can provide it to the commission as well as an update later on another meeting.
Yeah, because I think what we want to see is to see everything, kind of get a what you've done great here is to see the SB1, you know, everything that we're doing so that we have a real clean picture and for the community to know all the work that's being tasked and going to be under construction.
Absolutely. And, you know, as a separate comment, we have to do that evaluation anyway because we have to fund all this. We have to identify the funding source. We have to submit the reports to the funding authority. So we're doing this whole evaluation about how this one's getting done, the schedule, the timing. And so we'll present that with you. We're just not ready. We're just not there yet.
Thank you. Thank you,
Mr. Chair. So I'll
Commissioner Abelson.
That you were free. I just a quick question about, you mentioned slurry, and I know that's sort of indefinite, the slurry projects, but give a sense of a timeline without, you know, a specific date or even month maybe, but I'm just trying to get a sense because one of the streets on the slurry list is Grand. That's also one of the streets that's part of Slow Streets. So it's, which is fine. I just wanted to get a sense of when we might be starting to tackle the slurry projects.
Sure. The slurry, so the timing has to do with the project delivery, you know, actually bidding the project and getting the contractor in place, and also the timing of the year to do a project that makes sense to do at a particular time in the year.
slurry is better in, you know, not the dead of winter. So the plan is to complete the construction of the green streets in calendar year 2023. The slurry projects would be in like the springtime of 2024, probably about the same time as the orange projects, where, you know, the orange projects were still working on the water sewer component of that. The last project will probably be in 2024 will be the Mission Pasadena Arroyo reconfiguration. It'll be the last of the projects.
Okay, yeah. Great. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Okay, so I'll just kind of run through the next ones. Our North-South Corridor project, we are awaiting the environmental study approval from Caltrans. That's sort of like a milestone that we have to pass before we move into the design. We're reviewing all the feedback that we had from our public outreach meeting, and we will discuss that at a future MTEC meeting. As I alluded to tonight, the Fair Oaks SR-110 interchange loop ramp, we've been working with a consultant on a scope for the project approval environmental document phase of that project. So instead, we're taking the approach of instead of doing you know, this earlier sort of study about the corridor, we're fairly confident that this is a project we want to move forward with. It's just a matter of looking at all the alternatives and doing the environmental review and going through that that initial phase of the project. Now, that would be covered financially by the Measure M MIP money if we get approval from Metro about that scope. So our next step is to take the scope that we've developed and meet with Caltrans and Metro and our consultant to, you know, basically get buy-in that if we move forward, and that leads to a project, that funding is reimbursable under Measure R. So that's, you know, as we get this Fremont-Huntington project underway, that's going to be our next focus as far as large CIP projects for transportation matters, you know, not necessarily the street reconstruction efforts. Our Slow Streets program is moving right along. We have been working with the Alta and the Arroyo group staff on the conceptual design for the parklets. You'll see a item on the agenda tomorrow night to extend the K-Rail rental just a little bit further so we can meet our project schedule for the Mission Street implementation. What we're doing right now is actually installing the Slow Street program. We'll be going to council tonight to get approval to move forward with the installation. We took the commission's comments and applied them to the Slow Streets design as best as we could, including, you know, very helpful comments about we developed a lawn sign that sort of explains what's going on when you're in an intersection, you're walking by and you can see it. We also added a community survey that people can access at any time during the installation or after to sort of lend their opinion about what is going on and what do they think about it. So you'll see, if everything goes as expected tomorrow night, you'll see us start to mark that out first week of August, and we'll actually do the installation on the second week of August. So very soon the neighborhoods will be provided flyers that explains what we're doing and contact information for our staff in case there are questions. For the Ramona Oak, Oak Street, Rollin, Fremont Avenue traffic management, we've got two simultaneous efforts underway. One is working with our community development department on addressing the circulation issue with Holy Family. And the other is the installation of the loading zone in front of the high school. Our direction was to work with the school district on informing the parents of that installation before the school year. We've completed the flyer notification and getting the school district's buy-in to distribute that so that we can move forward with that project. The next one I'll highlight are the timing improvements for Orange Grove and Monterey and Mission and Garfield. We have received the single timing sheets from the consultant.
Our staff are not that familiar with reading timing sheets, so we are trying to we are working with the consultant to understand exactly what that the impact will be to the driver, so we can share that with you. And then once we understand that and that we confirm that's what we are intending to do with this update, we will provide those to our traffic maintenance signal operator, which we just got a new contract in place, so that they can be updated. The Arroyo Fest planning is moving forward. As the host city, we have sort of a special involvement in this project. Many cities are involved, but we're the lead along with Active SGV. So we have to establish a memorandum of agreement with for the execution of the project. Just the same thing we did for Mission to Mission. We had an agreement about city responsibilities versus the traffic control installer's responsibilities. And we also have to coordinate on our budget. We did the same thing for Mission to Mission about how much it actually costs us to put this event on. So that's what we're working on now. We're in the second revision of the traffic impact analysis for 625 Fair Oaks. That's a development project, which we will give you an update on when we get to that in our work plan. And I think the last things I'll mention are some of the work along Marengo and Huntington Drive. So both the Marengo Avenue traffic assessment and the Huntington Drive crossing guard evaluation will be on our council agenda tomorrow night. And for the Huntington Drive block review, we, per the commission's recommendations, we have a contractor that we're working with to install edge striping from Dos Robles to Olive Street on the south side of the street to, you know, as a interim measure before the larger work's done on Huntington to narrow that number three lane. So that's the work we're working on right now. So any questions on a target a specific item?
Any questions? Vice Chair Hughes?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'll try to be brief. You answered the question about the streets, but then I know we're looking at multiple bid projects in groups. Can we get those lists by groups so we know kind of what's out there and what's
absolutely
whenever it's convenient?
I mean, yeah, absolutely. Just in general, what you saw tonight, the green is one contractor. The orange is going to be two, probably.
Okay.
It'll be everything in orange except for Mission, Arroyo, Pasadena will probably be another bid. And then the slurry, Cape Sioux will be another one. Now it's possible it's the same contractor because they, you know, win the various bids, but it would be four different bid processes.
And then with that, is there a way to get potentially a list of, which we kind of used to have, a list of the projects and the dollar amounts? Because what we'd like to try to do is help be your advocate on budgets and where we're going and knowing what we're spending. And that would, I think, we could be a good help for that. If you
sure. Do you mean
knowing that you have the budget, you know, put down, because we know there's where all this other funding is, and making sure to help you and look at deadlines and, you know, funds have to be used by X. I just spoke to a colleague who just got back from Washington, D.C. and met directly with DOT, the Department of Transportation in D.C. And there is a lot of money that's supposedly going to be made available out of the Inflation Reduction Act, more so, particularly for kind of community projects, as I understand, that we're looking at. I mean, she literally said, this is the kind of stuff for your city, because we'd have conversations. But I'm just going to throw that out there as, you know, making
yeah,
sure
yes
that
on both items.
So
just to clarify, we're talking about transportation related items in our CIP that you'd like to see the budget for.
Correct.
Sure. So that is, we can do that.
Kind of a list of the items, the costs.
Absolutely. Point. And then on the other item, we're very much aware of that program. We're going to be bringing an item to council for one of our consultants to develop a safe streets for all action plan. So we can tap into that, some of that federal Department of Transportation funding.
Thank you. On the pedestrian crossing devices, you list as a new project. Do you have where those crossing devices? Says we're staff working with Metro representative to file the documents necessary in order to execute a funding agreement, but which devices are those?
So that was one of the that's one of the Measure M MSP projects. And so the there was a few locations that were recommended from the commission, and those were included in the funding request. The question right now is
so these are related to the Measure M project?
Exactly. Yeah. Okay. So there was a, I think there was some along Huntington. There was one at Gravelia and Park. We expect, you know, with how funding is going and project costs and inflation, that we probably won't be able to afford to do all the ones that we had intended with that funding. So we may want to reassociate some of those locations with either the HSIP funding that we pursued or the actual Huntington Fremont funding that we just talked about tonight. So it's just a matter of identifying which ones can be done for how much and what's the best selection. So we'll absolutely keep you in the loop on that. We have yet to get the, we are trying to work right now to get the funding agreement executed like all the other cities that receive money. So we're too early for that process, but we'll keep you involved as a commission in that process.
Okay, then I had made a note about the bollards for the farmers market and obviously Slow Streets. You're saying you're extending that contract. So I'm assuming that we could keep the artistic elements where we have it, where they're not going to exchange them out for different cement ones.
So we are going to exchange them out when we install the new equipment. This is just to, you know, allow the existing parklets to continue being there with the traffic barrier system. But what we're looking at with our consultant is actually, you know, ceasing to lease those and getting new ones, whether that's a purchase or a lease is a financial decision. But yeah, you won't see those particular K-rails hopefully past the installation.
I think whatever we do, we need to think of the artistic look at some point. Or
yeah, and that's why we have our designer on there, so that right now we're looking at ones that are a little bit more you know, they're a little more continuous, I guess you can say, like you can get different shapes, and then they're looking at the various cladding options for the K-rails.
Because I think before you were here, and I think Commissioner Fisher and Commissioner Abelson remember that there was photos that were shared of various configurations that various cities were doing for the Ralph Fresco and protecting different types of treatment devices, planters, things that were much more aesthetic and still could serve as you know, a defense for vehicle intrusion and such.
We're doing the same thing. The team we're working with has been involved in many of those projects. So we are looking at that. We, you know, planters, things like that. So that we'll have more information for you on what the engineer is recommending.
And I promise just a couple more. On your new projects list for highway safety improvement, you list a lot of Fremont there and Huntington there. So how's that going to segue with the Charette discussions?
This will be included. Okay, the nice thing about this is that, you know,
this is additional funding.
It's additional funding. Yeah.
Okay. So in addition to the 16 million,
exactly. We can carve these, we can carve these actual individually scoped components out of the 16 million and still implement them and discuss them during the SHRET process.
Okay. Yeah. And then going back to the timing on the Gold Line, it's saying looking at a task order. Do we know when that's going to be?
So that was our initial plan. In talking to Metro about the timing, we really need to, they're going to help us analyze it, but we need to give them a little bit more information. So basically what they had asked us for is like a very, like, us giving them when the issue occurred. And I know that Commissioner Fisher and I had talked about this, and we actually visited the site and took a look at it. So we know what the problem is. We described that to them exactly, but they think it has something to do with the purposeful lag when there's like two trains that are imminently present or had just been present. But we think that there's another issue there with the programming. And so what they've asked us to do is like give us the exact time and day this happened, and we'll look through our their logic logs. I don't know the correct term for it. And so they think they can help us if we can identify that. We may not need to get consultant input on it, but we do still have the earlier recommendations that we want to. I'm sorry, I have to jump back to this item because I'm losing my
place. The only reason I bring it up is because of if we're going to be doing everything on the slow streets, if there's a way to, I worry about, which we've talked about before, the crosswalk at Diamond, I think it's Diamond, and backing up. And then if you've got the timing issues with the crossing and all that, we're going to have two bottlenecks as we're trying to do the slow streets. So I'm just concerned about that.
Sure.
So I just want to bring that up and bring it, you know, to the forefront that we need to make sure that we're considering these backup bottleneck points as we roll this all out.
Yes, absolutely. That should be considered. What I was going to mention is that we know that there's previously requested preemption changes that of the known timing issues with it, besides the particular, I think it was like a 28 second delay that we were observing. So yeah, we absolutely understand that that is critical in terms of the road design for the project. Yeah.
And my last question.
Yeah. Vice Chair, here's one more question.
Last one. When you talked about the 626 Golden Streets and Arroyo Fest, you said that, you know, we have to get the agreement all done. I'm concerned because we're going to be in August and this is in October. Is there plenty of time to get this executed? And our responsibility is, quote unquote, a host city. Are they going to be promoting that they have their outreach budget, or does that fall on us? Or what's the scope of, because we want it to be successful, but if it's, that's a very short window.
Sure.
For partnerships, for sponsorships, for swag, for all that stuff. And that's what I'm just wanting to say. I just don't understand what's, you know, clearly what
sure. details are. Sure. So to alleviate your concern, it's essentially a repeat of the process that we had last year. So we are not too concerned about the execution because we already negotiated an MOU previously. And so largely we can just use that same language. And as far as the city responsibilities and costs, they're really associated with like the both the preliminary work to assess the traffic control plan, make sure the potholes are filled and the roadway is clear, if there's any electrical issues that we need to resolve beforehand, and then the day of public safety presence by police and fire. So it's really limited in that way. Active SGV, you know, I attended the event last year and it's like an army of active SGV folks that do everything. And so we really don't have a lot to do in that respect. They'll handle most of it. So we're pretty confident that we can get everything done. So we just did it last year.
Okay. But if we wanted our own South Pasadena Cool t-shirts or something to have, that would be on us.
It would be. So we're talking to the other, you know, city departments that would be involved in this. There is a lot of events on the calendar and a lot of co-sponsorship events. So we haven't yet decided what we'll be doing for this, if anything, if there's even any space for, you know, a really city-driven event. But yeah, we can, you know, if we can put on 4th of July like we just did, which is a ton of work, we'll be just fine for the site, okay, for this event.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank you. Commissioner Fisher? Nothing. Commissioner Abelson?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mindful of the time, I'll just a couple questions and a comment. First and foremost, thank you both for all the progress that's been made. It's fantastic. And I'm energized and excited about it. I would have said something different a year ago. So I thank you for that. Thank you also for adding the Garfield Monterey Road traffic signal onto the list. I appreciate that. Sorry, two quick questions. Columbia Street striping and signal improvements. Do we have a sense of the timeline within which the city of Pasadena is going to start commencing that work? And assuming that it's not tomorrow, following up on the suggestion that perhaps it's possible to proceed with certain interim striping measures on Columbia while maybe the bigger projects wind their way through the process?
Yes. So they are, they're still in their early phase of their process. I don't think they plan on making any substantial progress on this project until this coming fiscal year, which was, you know, or I'm trying to remember if it was 23, 24. It might be this fiscal year. I have to go back and look because we had that discussion last year. So, but yes, we are working on trying to get going through the procurement motions for striping projects. We're kind of starting with a very small project with this Huntington Edge striping and trying to put in something in place that's a lot more routine maintenance and trying to address that. So our focus is going to be on what we're doing on Huntington and then probably some work on Fremont, which could lead into what we do at
Columbia.
The only issue is that if we're going to really do anything new, it requires design work, and then it might be sort of double work in that respect. But we could try to address something.
Because an absolute minimum, if it were possible, because not knowing exactly how long it's going to take Pasadena to do what it is they're going to do, if we talking about edge striping, if it were at least possible to get edge striping on Columbia.
Yeah, edge striping might be possible. Anything else is Pasadena Street.
Right.
So because they already have a planning effort underway to redo the whole thing, it's unlikely we could have anything else done, but edge striping might be doable.
Yeah, that'd be great. Okay, thank you. And then last question, timing improvements, Orange Grove Monterey and Mission Garfield. So you addressed it a few minutes ago. My understanding that what we're talking about at Orange Grove and Monterey is improving the timing to improve the movement of Orange Grove traffic through that intersection because the wait time can be long. And then at Mission and Garfield, the approach was trying to improve the green time for Garfield, because right now it's a very long wait time to get to the intersection. Is that generally your understanding of what the goal is?
Yeah, we had an actual scope, the scoped work, and that's what we scoped for the work.
And they've given you the proposed adjustments to accomplish that.
Yeah, there was some complication. You know, they needed to access the original timing sheets in order to make that modification, which we had either didn't have or limited we had. And so they also identified some other functional issues with the signals, which might have led to some of the issue, like a detector not being aligned correctly, and did provide timing sheet updates. So we just have to, among all the other things we're doing, we just have to basically sit down and work out, like, okay, let's understand exactly what you're doing here. What do we have to do with our maintenance contractor to accomplish what you just said, as far as, like, that's the end goal.
So they've given you the suggestions or what's needed to take place in order to accomplish the goal. And now we're seeing how we're going to implement that.
Yes,
fair?
But we really want to understand, like, your timing was this beforehand. This is what we're changing. That'll help. This is what was wrong with the signal that you need to fix and why that is an issue. We just really want to deliberately understand what it is we're not just taking something from one consultant and giving it to a contractor and say, hey, go do this, because we want to make sure we did what we're supposed to do. So,
okay.
And we're not experts in this area, so we're really trying to just navigate that change.
Okay.
So
it's in process.
In process, very close.
Okay.
And everything is you understand, everything's baby steps, and we keep you very informed about every single step. So,
absolutely.
Yeah.
Thank you, Ted. Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you for the update, Ted. I just want to say thank you for including the educational and public feedback option in the slow streets design. I appreciate you kind of taking that input in, and I hope that we receive a lot of great feedback from the public. We will head to our next item, approval of the minutes of this special meeting last month. Remind me the date. I don't have the minutes in front of me.
June 20th.
So thank you, Vice Chair Hughes and Commissioner Abelson, for providing substantial edits to those. Do we have any last minute changes?
I don't have anything further.
I have just one. It's second paragraph under six, Commissioner Communications, second paragraph, second sentence, where it says he also requested that there are issues with the 110 freeway ramp. I don't even know the context in which that was said, unless someone else remembers.
So, Commissioner Fisher, I think you are referring to the original draft of the minutes that was included in the agenda packet. Does that sound right? Is that what you're looking at? There was a revised set sent out this afternoon.
Okay, then I didn't see it.
Which corrected the issue that you're raising.
Okay, then.
Would you like to read that sentence, Commissioner Anderson?
Yeah. I think Vice Chair. I detected what you just raised and deleted it, and then made an adjustment later to reflect what you actually talked about, which was Orange Grove and the safety issues on Orange Grove with the recent accident and pole knocked on Orange Grove and the Measure M project.
Okay, well, that sounds like...
Does that sound right?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you for that. Then never mind. I have no comments.
All right. Do we have a motion to approve the amended minutes?
I would so move acceptance of the revised minutes.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right. With that, we'll move on to Commissioner Communications. Who would like to kick us off?
All right. I guess I'll go.
Commissioner Anderson?
I'll be fast. I had more, but in consideration of time, I will keep it very brief and positive. Thank you, first, to staff for quickly hopping on the Martos Drive concerns raised at the last meeting and making an attempt to address some of the more severe conditions on the street, which I noticed taking place. Also, thank you to staff. I noticed over the past several weeks that there were improvements on Fremont. The parking tees were refreshed, the red zones were refreshed, a blinking light was repaired, and there might have been other things I didn't notice. So thank you to staff for hopping on those items and taking care of them so quickly. And that's it. Thank you.
Great. Commissioner Fisher?
Nothing.
Vice Chair Hughes?
I also want to thank staff for a very thorough agenda, and thank you for the updated information on the projects. I also wanted to commend for the work you guys did in helping with the 4th of July celebrations. I think a lot of the street repairs and things have been noticeable, and I had people comment to me mentioning things such as improvements on Fremont and such. So, and thank you for helping the residents regarding Martos. And I think we could probably figure out if there's other things we can do there. But I really appreciate it. Thank you. It's nice to see a responsive city. It's exciting. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Great. I guess I just somewhat have a general announcement. I understand this draft general plan is out right now for public comments. I understand there are some transportation related items in that. I don't know the deadline for that, but if you are someone listening to this meeting still at 8:30 on a Tuesday night, you're probably someone who is interested in commenting on the general plan. So encourage people to provide feedback on that. With that, I'll turn it over to staff for any staff communications.
Just really quickly, I had already mentioned that we'll be having a groundbreaking ceremony at Sterling Place in the cul-de-sac on Tuesday morning, the 25th. But I also want to mention, unrelated to this commission, that we'll be having we call it a community outreach meeting on Thursday evening at the library this Thursday, the 20th, starting at 6 p.m. And this is to go over some of the impacts of the trash SB 1383 regulation and then how that's going to be impacting the city. If you're a resident, you know, you're probably already doing this in terms of segregating your food waste, adding it to your yard waste in your quote green barrel. And then also if you're a business about having to implement some sort of organics diversion process, There's, you know, waivers in the process. There's monitoring that has to be done. There's new barrel deployment that has to be done. So we'll be sharing a lot of the details as well as what council is working towards and as far as amending or modifying our current waste hauler agreement. So if you'd like to join us at the community room in the library on Thursday evening, that's what we'll be doing Thursday night. Thank you.
Ted, what time was it on Thursday?
I think it starts at 6 p.m. Yeah, I will. Does anyone on our team know for sure? I'm pretty sure it's 6 p.m. Okay, thank you. 6 p.m., yes.
Great. Thank you.
Great. Liana, do you have any communications? Or Mark? All right. So with that, we will see everyone in August, and it is 8:30 p.m., and I'll call this meeting adjourned. Thank you.
Well, thank you.
I did it.
Look at that.
Right.